All right. Good morning. My name is Rajesh. I'm a program manager in the BizTalk team. And today, we're going to take a look at how we can build hybrid applications using BizTalk servers, as well as the new BizTalk services which we have just shipped. To start with, what I would like to do is talk a little bit about how the enterprise landscape is today, typically, and where it goes towards, and take a look at what are some of the common integration patterns which come into picture. To start with, you traditionally have an enterprise in on-premise where you have all your LOB applications, ERP systems, data, archival storage, everything on-premise. Now, you may not move everything to the cloud, but you do feel there are certain class of applications or certain sets of services through which you can move to the cloud. And that's where we are saying that you may not move everything, but you might find ways and means in which you can move certain aspects of your LOB applications or adopt new cloud services. In this case, we are giving an example where, for example, instead of using CRM on-premise, you might move to dynamic CRM online. At the same time, there are a certain class of LOB applications. For example, your vacation approval process or your expense management system, where it might be easier to move to the cloud as opposed to moving your ERP from on-premise to the cloud. So as we move towards these sorts of cloud integration patterns, how does integration play a role? So in this talk, what I will do is pivot the entire session around two key themes. One, how do you enable integration between on-premise to the cloud? And how do you enable integration between cloud to on-premise? And the key thing to note here is, typically, we don't dictate whether you want to move to the cloud or not. Usually, it's a decision based on your business needs. So you might choose to run all your applications on-premise, and it's completely fine to do so. And you can move to cloud at your own terms, at your own pace. So when you do that, how can you integrate your existing processes from your on-premise to the cloud? And this is where we're going to take a look at some of the new cloud connectivity features which we have introduced in BizTalk Server 2013 and give a quick glimpse in terms of how easy it is for us to go ahead and configure these cloud services and enable the connectivity between on-premise to the cloud. So that is one part of the talk. And the second part of the talk is to focus on how do we enable connectivity between the cloud services to on-premise. So typically, this is where you run your, for example, your vacation approval system in the cloud, your expense management system in the cloud. How do you take the data from there and integrate it with your on-premise LOB system? How do you handle that data flow? By a quick show of hands, how many of you were present as part of the introduction to Windows Azure BizTalk Services session, which was there on Monday? Okay, I see a few of you. So what I'm going to do is the demo which I showed there in terms of the scenario, we are going to build it end-to-end today and take a look at how we can do that from a development perspective. So I'll start with first the on-premise to cloud story. So here the problem statement is the same, what I talked about earlier, where today you have all your LOB applications on-premise, but as you move to the cloud, there are certain class of applications which might be more easy or more amenable to move to the cloud. For example, you might want your backup storage to be in the cloud, or you might want to do online collaboration. In this case, Office 365 is a very good example. Or you want to connect to some SaaS applications, be it in terms of Salesforce, CRM online, et cetera. So how do you go about doing that? The key thing here is you're not changing your processes. It's just that one of your endpoints or one of your components in your overall data flow is now moved to the cloud. For example, your storage solution or your CRM solution is now in the cloud. But your entire process might still be on-premise. So how do you go about doing it? Now, this is where what we have done as part of BizTalk Server 2013 is we have enabled a whole class of new cloud connectivity services. Especially the things to note, we have created a whole new experience for connecting to REST endpoints, REST services. You can do all sorts of operations, invoke a REST service, do all the common HTTP methods, like you can do HTTP put, get me all the account details, delete this particular account, and there's a whole set of richness associated with it. And the question is not only about consuming REST services, but you should also be able to expose REST services, which means that you can take your LOB application, take the specific data, expose the REST endpoint, not only internally on-premise, but you should also be able to expose it so that you can create new experiences from your side, be it in terms of creating new form factors. For example, you can create an app for the mobile client or the tablet, and then still call the REST services which connect to your on-premise LOB system. So these are very, very interesting ways in which you can take your existing data and enable new experiences on top of it. And the second part of cloud connectivity features which you want to quickly talk about today is in terms of how do you enable connectivity to service bus, right? Service bus is really useful in a certain set of scenarios where you want to, for example, store and forward, where you get the data, you move your LOB application to the cloud, but you don't want direct point-to-point connectivity between your LOB application and the cloud to the on-premise systems. So to do that, you will send the data to service bus queue, which in turn enables a brokered messaging scenario. And from there, the downstream applications can then take the data and consume it at its own pace. And in this case, BizTalk Server 2013, out of the box, gives a lot of really rich functionality in which you can get the data from service bus, send data to service bus, as well as preserve service bus specific properties. So service bus uses a notion called brokered message properties, where you have a message body and you have a key value pair of the property bag. So now you can take that context and preserve it when you're consuming into BizTalk. So you can convert the context from service bus brokered message properties to BizTalk server context properties. That way it gives you a lot of richness in enabling your data flows. So today, as part of this session, what we're going to do is quickly take a look at some of the ways in which we can do it. So we're going to take a look at how you can connect to Azure storage in the cloud out of the box using BizTalk Server 2013. And also you're going to take a look at how you can connect to Office 365. And typically when you have a SharePoint solution, till date, the way it works is that you have a BizTalk server, you have a SharePoint server, and in each of the SharePoint nodes, you have to go ahead and install a web service, and that web service in turn relays the communication between BizTalk and the SharePoint node. And the problem is it's a problem of scale. If you have a SharePoint node with like a SharePoint form with 100 nodes, you need to have the web service in each of the 100 nodes. And it especially becomes complex when you want to connect to Office 365. It's a SaaS application. Now, how do you go about installing a web service in a SaaS application? You can't, but still you need to enable the connectivity. So the second demo you'll see today is how you can connect to Office 365 from BizTalk Server 2013 or other box. And there is a lot of other useful features in terms of some of the complex variations in which you can do REST services, expose REST services, connect to service bus, or receive a message from service bus. We are going to see all those permutations and combinations in tomorrow's talk. There is a session on introducing BizTalk Server 2013. And we are going to go deep into it. Here we are going to take a quick look at some of the demos which I mentioned. So let me quickly switch over to the demo machine. All right. So I'm going to build things from scratch, and then we can see how easy it is as we move along. To start with, I'll go ahead and create an app. Let me start with the SendPort experience. The first thing which I want to do is I have a Azure storage account. So in this case, let me go ahead and show you. This is my Azure account where I created a storage, and this particular storage account has a container. Go ahead. Yeah.
Quick question. You're using this on-premise?
Yes. So not yet. So as part of the first session of the demo, what we're going to see is how you can connect to cloud services from BizTalk Server 2013. So it is the server part, correct? All right. So I've created a storage account, and in this storage account, we have a container. So we're going to see how we can take data from on-premise system and then push data to the storage account using BizTalk Server 2013. So here I'm going to create a new send port, and let me just call it as so here, one of the things you'll notice is that we have introduced a whole bunch of new adapters, and this specifically in terms of WCF Web HTTP adapter, this is the adapter we use to connect to cloud REST endpoints. So in this case, Windows Azure Storage, like all Windows Azure services and cloud services, they provide REST interface to connect to the Azure Storage. So I'm going to click on the new adapter and click on its configuration. So what you'll see here is that there are a bunch of things to keep in mind. The very first thing you'll notice is that you need to give an endpoint, like what is a REST endpoint you want to hit, and what kind of operation you want to invoke. So there are different ways. For example, you might want to create a new text file, in which case you're going to perform a put operation. You might want to delete the existing file, in which case you want to do a delete operation. So there are different operations you can do, and the way you would invoke is, so in this case, I know that Service bus already provides, sorry, Windows Azure Storage already provides a REST endpoint, and in this case, it's a put method where we're going to go ahead and say, go ahead and create a new file in Azure Storage. So I'm going to copy the same syntax here, and we have to modify a few things. The first thing to modify is that the storage account name is different. In this case, my storage account name is okay, let me write it down. BTS decade storage dot blob dot windows dot co dot net. And my container name, which we just saw, was data. And I want to name the file as demo.txt. And I'm going to say, in this case, I'm going to perform only one operation. So I'm going to name it as a put operation. And then when you're sending the data, there are a few things to keep in mind. You're sending data over a secure channel, HTTPS. So you have to go ahead and say the channel is secure. And then the interesting part about cloud services is that most cloud services have their own authentication scheme. For example, Azure Storage has a key value pair where you name the storage account and the key. If you take Salesforce, it has its own OpenAuth protocol. If you take Service Bus, it supports ACS. So one of the things we enable for all new adapters in BizTalk Server 2013 is that if you're talking to a service which understands access control service, you can provide authentication out of the box. You don't have to write your own behavior. But the thing where it differs is for services like Azure Storage, for services like Salesforce, where it's not the ACS authentication you're dealing with, you have to write your own behavior because the platform is extensible. Out of the box with BizTalk Server 2013, what we also provide is we provide a separate behavior extension for connecting to cloud storage. In this case, I'm going to say I'm going to connect to Azure Storage. Click on it. And as part of its behavior, you'll see two things. What is the name of the storage, and what is its account details? So I'm going to say BTS get demo storage, and then name of the file is, let me see. Okay, I copied the storage account key. So we are done. And we'll come to the message part of it later, but I just want to take a quick minute and talk about the last part of it, the outbound message properties. And this is something which we introduced after we released the beta version of BizTalk Server 2013 and before we shipped the final RTM version. And the key thing to note here is when you're performing a get operation, right, get me the list of accounts, you're just doing an HTTP endpoint, get, but you won't have any message body. But BizTalk can't work without a message body. So when you send a message out, you always have to truncate the message body before sending out. And that's very common for common verbs like get or delete, because you're just specifying the operation, either get the message or delete the message. So what we have done is instead of you writing your own like custom pipeline component, you can just say, whenever I'm doing a get method, suppress the message body. Whenever you're doing a delete, suppress the message body. So in this case, we're just doing a put operation. So I'm going to leave it as is. So now we have done our connectivity. So all we did as part of the configuration is go ahead and specify the endpoint, what kind of operation to perform, and specify the Azure storage behavior. So with this set, we should be able to go ahead and send the data to the Azure storage. So I'm just going to quickly go ahead and create a stub, see port one, it's okay. So here, let me go ahead and so now we have got the data. We are going to post the data in this particular location, and then we are going to see it reflected in Azure storage. So we'll quickly go ahead and create, and I'll say, accept any text files. Go ahead. So now we established the connectivity. The only missing part is that you have to link the receive port and send port. In this case, I'm going to create a subscription. That's it. So now we'll go ahead and start this application. What we'll do is we'll take the data from on-premise and then like push it out to the cloud. So let me go to the TechEd demo and just create a copy this and put it here. And let's quickly make sure that it's always when you're doing a live demo, as you go. And maybe I gave the endpoint wrong, BTS. So the endpoint is wrong. So it's BTS TechEd demo. Storage. Right. So that was because of a namespace mismatch. All right. Let's try again. All right. Think it should have gone through. So let's switch over to the Windows Azure storage. This is a container. I see demo.txt. But so now what we have seen is just using the REST endpoint, how we can connect to like the cloud services. But this is a very, very simplistic scenario wherein I specify the endpoint, I know it was a put, and I gave the exact name details. But typically when you do a REST operation, you want it to be context sensitive. For example, when I'm going ahead and creating a file, I need to specify what the name of the file is. I need to specify how its behavior, which file I'm creating, or which file I'm deleting, etc. So we can do that as well. So the way you would go ahead and change it is I just created another send port, in this case, an hybrid app one. So instead of walking you through the same creating the receive port, send port, et cetera, I just want to take a minute and talk about the new URL mapping. And this is really, really key when it comes to the new REST services, which we have, REST behaviors, which we have exposed in BizTalk server. The first thing you would notice is that there's a URL mapping. And the reason this is important is because on the same endpoint, on the same Azure storage endpoint, you can perform multiple operations. Like, for example, create a file, delete a file, create a specific instance of the file, etc. So you can go ahead and specify as many operations as you want. And while specifying the operations, you also need it to be dynamic. For example, in this case, I'm going to go ahead and create a file, and instead of saying create demo.txt, I'm saying that the data container, create a placeholder, because the way this is the syntax we have, wherein within curly braces, you provide your placeholder name. And then there's a notion of a variable mapping. So So this is where we are saying that the data which you want to send at the when you're finally making the REST API call should be based on your incoming properties, based on your message flow, based on your business flow. So in BizTalk, while you're processing, you can promote the context properties. And here you can say that so the way you should read this is, I'm going to make a REST API call to Azure Storage, and I'm going to make a put operation. And as part of it, I'm going to create a file in the data container. And the name of the file is determined dynamically. And how it's populated is via the property namespace, where we say that as part of the receive file name, whatever file name I'm actually putting in the Azure Storage, that is going to get reflected in the final option. Okay, thank you. And so with this done, let's go ahead and see how we create the file instance here. So I've wired up the same Azure Storage. So in this case, let me go ahead to another receive location. So I'm going to create an Azure Storage file here. I'll drop the file. And in this case, let's also make sure that it went through. And if you go to the Windows Azure portal, you'll see a new file. Only in this case, it's going to create the file with a different file name, right? So it hasn't come here yet. Probably you should refresh this. I'll go back to So it will take the file name based on your whatever file name you actually put on your on-premise, the file share location. So there are a couple of things which we saw here as part of it. The first thing as part of the takeaways is that we have a new adapter, a web HTTP adapter, using which you can make REST API calls. And as part of making the API calls, you can invoke all the operations, whichever operation you want. For example, if you want to do a patch, you can do that as well. And the second part of it, it need not be static. It is dynamic. And the way you handle dynamic operations is via the new variable mapping, or, which we just saw now. So with this said, let me move to the second part, where we have an existing SharePoint site in Office 365, and you want to connect the data to it. So I'll log into the SharePoint site first. Let me bring it up. So it looks like I'm already logged in. There you go. So I just logged into my Office 365 account. So here you will see I logged in with .onmax.com, which is the endpoint. And my namespace is AFB2B1. So in this case, I have a specific document library. Now, we want to make sure that we get data from your on-premise systems and move it to the Cloud 365, Office 365 application. So what we're going to do is, I'll go ahead to my existing implementation. And as part of the new, some of the changes we made in SharePoint adapter, we are going to use the Windows SharePoint Services SDK. And let me see if I can actually try to zoom in. All right. I think this makes sense. Okay, these are the new SharePoint adapters configuration properties. The first thing to note is that you see a new property called use client OM. So we are using the client object model of SharePoint to connect to it. And as part of the new client object model, you no longer have a dependency on a separate way of authenticating to SharePoint. You can directly call the SharePoint endpoints and communicate and authenticate with it. So in this case, we're going to do that. And then what we're going to say is connect to my SharePoint site, which I just logged into. And as part of the destination, I'm going to send it to a specific document library, which we saw there. And we are going to create a file with the generic GUID extension. And the only other thing you have to specify, apart from giving the configuration endpoints, is to go ahead and specify the SharePoint online username and password. So typically, when you connect to your SharePoint on-premise, you already have access to it. You have SSO authenticated locally in BizTalk. So now, with SharePoint 360, like Office 365, the authentication details vary. So now you have to go ahead and authenticate it using the username and password. So here we have a new configuration for doing that. So I've already done that, and I've went ahead and wired up. Let me zoom it back in. All right. I've wired it to receive port. So I'm going to drop a file in the on-premise system. We're going to consume it and put it in Office 365. So let me go to the file system again. I'll take the same file. Hybrid app one. Gets consumed from here, and let's go back to Office 365. You now see a new file which got created, and it's the same file which we sent it earlier as well. So what you saw here is a couple of quick ways in which you can connect to like cloud services from BizTalk server. And we provide out-of-the-box connectivity to like Office 365, and our SharePoint experience has improved a lot. And the other thing to keep in mind is if you're connecting to REST services, and if your REST service makes use of ACS authentication, we provide support out-of-the-box. And if it is Azure storage, we have a specific behavior, WCF behavior, which you ship. We just saw how we can use that and connect to Azure storage as well. If you're talking to other cloud services, like Salesforce, like CRM Online, or any of the other services, you can write your own authentication extenders, WCF behaviors, and then go ahead and connect to it. So we have a really rich functionality. And tomorrow, as part of the BizTalk server session, we'll actually see how we can expose REST services as well and connect to various different form factors, be it mobile clients or tablets. So with this said, let me quickly switch over to the PPT. And we'll focus on the second part of the demo. So in this case, we're going to see how we can connect from cloud services to on-premise LOB systems. And to give a context, we are going to make use of the new Windows Azure BizTalk services, the one which you just shipped in on Monday, and take a look at how you can connect to your existing on-premise LOB systems and connect it to clouds, enable the data flow between them. So here, I'll quickly walk through the scenario again. I think majority of you were there on Monday, but for those of you who were not there, I'm just going to give a quick recap of the scenario. And then we will go to Visual Studio and see how we can create that application. So I'll walk through the scenario here. So you have an existing customer who have their data on-premise. In this case, the customer is a retailer, which means that they have various channels in which they get their sales data. And we want to integrate the sales data from all the different systems to their on-premise LOB system. So the very first channel they have is they have a sales channel which sends the data via point of sale integration system. This would typically be retail outlets, wherein you have various retail outlets and people go and pay cash in the counter. The cash counter makes use of point of sale systems. So it enters the data and keys into the data. And typically the point of sale systems have a couple of different ways. They can either transmit the data live, like real time, or they send end of day sales data. So that is one way in which they collect the sales information. The other way they can collect the sales information is via the web portal, wherein they have an e-commerce web portal, and people can go ahead and go online, place their orders, and that communication happens real time. So that is another way where you get the sales data, or like the sales information from. And finally, they will have partner organizations For example, this is typically for business, wherein as a business, I place order to the retailer and they have to enable that exchange. So in this flow, the problem statement is simple. Irrespective of how many channels they have, they need to make sure that they get the data from these various channels and expose it in their on-premise LOB system. So there are a few challenges here. I'm going to quickly walk through it since most of you were already there. The very first thing is across these different channels, the message type format is typically different. You might get flat files, you might get XML files, you might get standard specific files like EDI. So how do you handle this message disparity? That is one part of the problem. The second part of the problem is how do you handle different transports? You might get data from like an end of day system like a secure location in FTP to a real time communication via HTTP or business specific protocols such as ACE2. So this is another thing which you need to take care of. And finally, when you take the data from these different protocols and you want to bridge it to your on-premise system, that might have a different protocol. So how do you enable protocol bridging is another facet to the same problem. Then comes the notion of security. Now we are talking about different trust domains, right? Because you have your LOB system on-premise and you have all the other systems somewhere else. Like you might have a web store app running in the cloud or FTP location which is outside. So how do you enable security? How do you make sure that you give the right amount of information? And finally, the question comes with respect to scale. When you're creating an app and deploying an app, let's say the retailer just increases their store across the country by tenfold, do you have to change your app? That's one aspect, one way of looking at it. Or when you look at the e-commerce website, how do you handle the scale during Black Fridays, during holiday season, or during a major product launch? Do you have to change your deployment, or do you have to do something different to handle that scale? And finally, when it comes to partner organizations, how do you handle the scale with respect to going ahead and stating that I want to reach out to other businesses and onboard them as quickly as I can? So these are typically problems when it comes to scale. And finally, not to say the least, when you deploy a solution and manage it end to end, the core manageability aspect comes into picture. How can you view your artifacts? How can you update your artifacts? How can you redeploy your solutions, et cetera? The whole question of manageability comes into picture. So now, the way we solve that is using Windows Azure BizTalk services. The fundamental building block of Windows Azure BizTalk services is what we call as a bridge. And this is an entity which takes your it consists of three parts. It consists of a source, a core pipeline processing, and a destination. So in a way, it models your flow from start to finish. For example, in this screen, when you take a look, your end-to-end flow is from a FTP shared location in point-of-sale system to a core processing to an on-premise LOB system. So you have a source, you have some processing, and then you have a final destination. So that is how the bridge is modeled as well. And then comes the unique nature of saying that you get data in different formats, in different protocols, in different ways and means. How do you handle that and then convert it to the target system requirements? So you need a way to validate the message, transform the message, and finally route it to the on-premise systems. And one of the out-of-the-box templates we'll see in Visual Studio as well is what we call as a VETR pattern. So it stands for validate, enrich, transform, enrich, and route. And what it allows is, as soon as you get a message, as far as your core processing is concerned, what is the integration pattern? So you typically validate a message, and once you validate, you want to transform to the target system's data format, and then you finally want to route it. So these are ways in which we enabled it. And the final missing piece, and this is the part which I'm going to focus a lot today when you're building the app, is to talk about the new BizTalk adapter service. And this is the component as part of our release which enables exposing the on-premise LOB applications as a secure cloud endpoint. For example, if you want to expose data from your SAP system and expose it as a secure cloud endpoint, how do you do that? If you want to take your data from your SQL system and expose it securely, how do you do that? Out of the box, we support connectivity to all major LOB applications like SQL, Siebel, Oracle, and SAP. And you can think of it this way, right? It's basically taking the BizTalk adapter pack, for those of you who know about BizTalk. Take that adapter pack, enable that connectivity. Only in this case, you are making it a whole lot richer because we are now exposing it to a cloud endpoint, and that enables you new possibilities. Like, for example, if you want the SAP data through your mobile device and make sure that you are able to track the inventory and things like that, you can now do that. And the barrier of entry is really, really low, and the experience is also really smooth. So we will take a look at how we can enable that flow. So in this case, what we are going to do is we have around 35 minutes left. So we are going to model this entire scenario, right, and focus especially on the how do you enable LOB integration and show it end-to-end. This is going to be using the new Windows Azure BizTalk services. So with this said, what I'll do is I'll quickly switch over to the demo machine. And you'll notice a couple of things. The first thing is I'm going to create a brand new project, and you will see a new BizTalk services template. And this is part of the new SDK. So when you do it, let me quickly also show the difference. So there is a BizTalk service template, which is going to be the new modeling pane in which you're going to model the source, the data flow between the source and the target systems. This is different from the BizTalk server project template, right? So if you also have BizTalk server installed in the machine, you will see a new, you'll see the traditional BizTalk server project template. These are different, and once we go into the details, you'll see why. So let me go ahead and create this BizTalk project. Let me name it as Tech Hybrid. Okay. The very first thing you will see is that it opens a new configuration pane. So this pane which you see here is for messageflow.bcs. BCS stands for Bridge Configuration Surface. So this is where you will model your data flow. And as part of talking about modeling, I talked about source, core pipeline processing, and destination. So out of the box, if you go to the toolbox, you'll see the items or activities structured along the same lines. You'll see different sources. For example, I can get data from an FTP source or an HTTP or SFTP source, and I can take a one-way bridge. So if you look at the bridges, there are some common templates which we enable out of the box. You can either take a message, do nothing about it, and then just pass through to a target system. There you can use the pass-through bridges, or you want to take a message, do some processing, and send to an endpoint, but you don't want to send anything back to the original caller. In that case, you can make this a one-way bridge. Or you want request-response scenarios, wherein you have a web server calling the bridge endpoint, and it expects a response. Whether you completed the operation, what was it successful, was it a failure, positive acknowledgement or negative acknowledgement, in which case you can make use of the new, the XML two-way bridge. And the other inherent thing to note is bridges by default are HTTP enabled. So when you deploy a bridge, you already support HTTP protocol. In addition, if you want to get data from FTP source or SFTP source, you can drag and drop the FTP source or like SFTP source location. So in this case, for our flow, we have an FTP source as the source. You have a core processing unit. And then comes the notion of you want to send it to an on-premise SQL system. So what I'm going to do is quickly switch over to the Server Explorer. And as soon as you install the SDK and you install, we have what we call as a BizTalk adapter service, you'll see a new entry in the Server Explorer pane. And the way you could think about it is, here is the IIS manager, and once you install, there's a new BizTalk adapter service. We host a service here, and let's go ahead and navigate to it. I think it came up. Yeah. So what we are going to do, as part of the BizTalk adapter service, is something that's pretty simple. you have the BizTalk adapter pack, which already has connectivity to LOB application like SQL, Oracle, etc. You take that connectivity, host it in IIS, right, and then expose it as a relay using service bus. So it's exposing a service bus endpoint, and the host of that service bus endpoint is going to be in IIS. And that communication in turn gets relayed to the LOB systems. So now suddenly you get a scale which was previously not possible. So if you had to do it previously, there are a few ways you can enable reverse proxy, put a machine in DMZ, and then enable connectivity. Or you could basically say, I'm exposing, creating a firewall exception for that particular port, and then enabling it. With service bus and BizTalk adapter pack, and we make use of Windows Server App Fabric to make sure that you enable auto start, etc. We now enable LOB applications to be connected from any cloud service. And so the power of it is really simple. Let's walk through in terms of, if you have an existing SQL table, how do you take that SQL table operation and expose it as a cloud endpoint? So I'll switch back to the same Visual Studio machine. And as part of the LOB types, I already talked about all the LOBs we support. I'm going to add a new SQL target. So you can think about a target as a service bus endpoint to which you're going to send the message. So I'm going to say add new SQL target. Let me see if I can do it while showing it. And is that clear? Okay. I have a local SQL server, and I have a SQL Express. And the name of the database is AutoStickB. I'm going to connect via my credential. And as soon as you connect, it goes ahead and says it fetches all the all the objects which is there in the SQL system. In this case, I'm going to select the table as part of orders. And in orders table, what do you want to do? So in this case, I want to do an insert operation on the table. So I'm going to say do an insert operation. And then now we have the access to it. Then click next. And next comes the question of, because we are hosting in IIS, the data gets relayed. And then you have to talk to the LOB systems. Different LOB systems have different forms of authentication. For example, SQL supports SQL authentication, Windows authentication. SAP supports a different authentication. So for this particular LOB, in this case SQL, I have to specify how do I want to connect to it. So I'm going to say I'm going to use a Windows credential. I'll go ahead and key in my username password. So after the connectivity is established, we have the notion of a target and a subpath. And this is really important. So I'll just take a couple of moments to explain what it is. When you expose a target, and that target is basically an operation or endpoint you expose in the cloud. But you might expose an endpoint for SAP or SQL and perform multiple operations in it. For example, I can expose the orders table. I can perform insert, update, delete, etc. Those are different operations, sub-operations. But you still want to have a top-level connection to your SQL system. So the top-level way of looking at it is the notion of a target. So in this case, what I'll do is we have an existing service bus endpoint. So I'm just going to key in the details. So the name of the service bus endpoint is ESTechNS, show secret. So these are basically connection parameters through which you connect to SQL. Here I'm going to say the target is, let's say, ticket orders, and then put the target path as insert. Right? So let me magnify again. And then just walk through. Now, the thing you notice is we are going to say that we are going to create a new service bus relay endpoint through which you're going to connect. And the subpart is insert. I'm going to do an insert operation. And we'll see the target runtime URL. So this is a service bus relay endpoint which is going to get hosted as soon as you do it. So I'm going to go ahead and say click next. It will give a summary of the orders, like things which you have done so far. And then finally, I can click create. So now what has happened is we have successfully created a relay endpoint, which is going to talk to SQL. It's going to perform an insert operation. And to actually make a case and understand this in detail, what I'll do is I'll go back. First, you see that as part of the Server Explorer, the new insert operation which we did gets reflected. And let's do one more thing. In addition to insert, I also want to do a update operation. So we'll go ahead and select the same orders table. Oh, sorry. Let me remove that. Thank you. Let me do one update. And again, say that I'm going to connect via my username and password. And then now the thing you will notice is that you can either go ahead and create a new relay endpoint or target endpoint as we did before, or you can say that I'm going to make use of the existing target and say that the subpath is update. So this way you can do what is multiplexing. You can have the same channel, like you'll have different subpaths for different operations, right? So that way when you manage your service bus endpoint, like saying that you have a separate plane for the headers, like the particular endpoint and service bus, that in turn flows through all the remaining like sub endpoints. So I'll go ahead and create, and you'll see that the endpoints are created and up and running. So the other thing you'll notice is, okay, I created the entry in the SQL system, I've exposed it as a relay endpoint. Now how do I know what is the structure of the table? I have to send the data to SQL. So what is the XML message I have to send? What is the structure of the XML message? So you can go ahead and right-click on the, for example, insert operation, and you'll see an option called add to the existing project. If you already have a BizTalk project open, it will allow you to add the schemas to it. So in this case, it pops open a schema generation wizard. You can give a unique file name, and you can give the LOB credentials as well. Now once you do this, a couple of things happen. All the operations, all the schemas which you require to make the SQL connection is now present as a XSD file. So if you want to make a insert a new row in SQL, you have to send an XML file with this particular structure, right? And it gives an insert response, which basically gives an acknowledgement saying, hey, whether the insert was successful or not. So this is one way. So now we have enabled the connectivity like a service bus endpoint in the cloud. Let's see whether it's actually is up and running or not. So once, So once you create a target, let's go back to IIS and let's refresh the BizTalk adapter service. So you'll see that for each of the targets which you have created, we have a corresponding host in IIS. I'm sorry, you had a question? Yep. So it's the same thing. I selected a table and did a direct operation like insert, but you can also select a stored procedure. So again, the schemas get generated out of the box. You just need to make sure that you set the right input parameters and get the corresponding output parameters and things like that. So it should work just the same. So, and for each of the target paths you create, there's a corresponding host in IIS, and this is what is going to host and expose your service bus endpoint in the cloud. So with that said, let me quickly switch over. You can click on the insert operation, and you'll see one specific thing, the runtime address. So this is the endpoint in service bus. So let me quickly open IE and see if this endpoint is up and running. So now it says that, hey, the endpoint is up, you're trying to connect to it, but I haven't specified the ACS credential. So I haven't specified how to authenticate to it. So it's failing. Now, if you provide the right ACS token, it'll go ahead and connect to it. So let's come to that part in terms of how we provide the ACS token in a bit. So now we have modeled our source. We have put something as a pipeline. We haven't done anything about it yet. And we know where to send the data to. And that endpoint can be connected from the cloud. So the easiest way is click on the insert operation, drag and drop to the bridge configuration surface. Now you have modeled your data flow, wherein you have your source, you have processing, you have the target system. So let's go ahead and connect these two. So if you go to toolbox, there's a notion of a connector. You can connect to it. And then when you go here, enable the connection. Go here, enable the connection. Right? So we enable the data flow. Then comes a question saying that when you actually get the message, what kind of messages do you expect to be sent? So I'm going to make a really, really quick message. Let's say it requires date, time, region, ID. So I'm just going to say I need item ID and quantity. Right? Everything else, I'll leave it as blank for the purpose of the demo. So you can go ahead and say, create a new item. In this case, we provide support for artifacts like schemas, both XML and flat file. If you already have an existing flat file, you can generate the flat file schema from an existing flat file as well. We have a wizard. This is the same as the BizTalk 2010 flat file generation wizard. We'll come to this a little later. So I'm going to create a schema, leave it a schema one. And okay, I'm just going to say orders. And all I need as part of orders is item ID and quantity. These are the only two values which I'm going to get. So if you go to here, I just want to make sure that item ID is string and quantity is int. So I'll just change the quantity data type to. So it models. Now I can send data to SQL. So the next question is, I have my source format, which is different from the format required by SQL. So how do you bridge the data transformation? To do that, you can create a new transform. And you will see the map. Let me see if I can. Is it visible from the end? I think so. So I'll just leave it as map one. And the map is a visual surface in which you can model your like data format disparity, like which data from the source goes to the target. And one thing which I'd like to state here is that this is not the same mapper which you see in the stock server. In the stock server, you typically have a BTM file wherein it has the same visual representation. You have a source, you have a target, you have a designer pane in between. But the formats are fundamentally different. In BizTalk server, you build, you get a DLL, you deploy it. Here, you have a TRFM file. If you notice the extension, it is where is the file? It's called map1.trfm. So that is a transform file which we have created. And here, we have made some really good improvements out of the box. So I'll walk you through it in the context of the schema which you just created. So in this case, I'm going to say that I want to map the pane, map the incoming message to schema1.xst. And then I want to map it to an insert operation. So I'm going to go and say, I'm going to do an insert op, do an insert. And the data formats are different here between the source and the target. So I'm going to say map the item ID to the item ID, map the quantity to quantity. So in this case, it's pretty straightforward. But there are a few like functoids, if you will, out of the box, which is different and which is new in BizTalk services, which is not there in BizTalk server. So let me take a couple of moments to explain what those are. So if you come down, let's see. The first, I'll start with the looping operations. Typically in BizTalk server, when you connect to ERP systems or when you have a really complex map, you inevitably have the need for looping through certain items and then producing the target message. You, in BizTalk server, you used to make use of the looping functoid and then go ahead and do it. But in the case of complex looping, say nested looping, or you want to do normalization or across nested looping structures, it becomes really complex. So you typically end up writing XSLT, or you have custom scripting functoids which you make use of. Here, what we have done is we understand looping is a very common mechanism, and we provide out-of-the-box support for two new functoids. One is called for each loop, and one is called map each loop. What these do is, in a BizTalk server looping functoid, if you do a loop, you're expected to have a target. Whereas in some cases, all you have to do is just loop through the operations and populate in-memory variable. You used to have variables, you have accessibility, and things like that. Now we can do that using the for each. So you have no obligation to create a target endpoint. And then you have a map each, where for all the elements you have collected, you can now map it to a target destination. So that makes it really useful. But still, it doesn't solve the problem saying, how do you hold in-memory data? Let's say you create variables, you want to store it in memory. How do you go about doing it? So for that, we have created a new list operation, like create list and add item to the list. And this is also new to the TRFM functionality in Windows Azure BizTalk service. So what the list operation allows you to do is create in-memory variables. Like when you're doing a loop and you want to take specific values and just have it in the context of the map, you don't want it later on, you can create a loop. So with these, it's really powerful to go ahead and create really complex maps. And as part of one of our customers we are doing as part of the internal TAP program, they were able to take an existing external map, like a EDI format, take it to IDOC, and they did the entire thing using SSLT, because these are complex maps. And then they changed it saying that, hey, using the new capabilities in TRFM, how do you go about doing it? They were able to do the entire EDI to IDOC flow using the new for each and map each. And we have actually, if I'm not wrong, we have published an MSDNS file. I'll give a link to it later. But this is one really key thing to keep in mind. With some of the new functionalities we have enabled, all the existing complex problems, if you will, which was always difficult to do, we have made it a whole lot simpler. So with this, let me go back to the Visual Studio. Now we have created our schema and the map. Next, the question is, how do you tie it together? Sorry. So the very first thing you have to specify is, when you get a message, what kind of messages do you want to validate against? Do you accept any kind? Yeah, okay. It still supports 1.0. So we do not have support for 2.0 yet, but we are working towards it, because .NET framework it doesn't support 2.0 yet. So we are trying to make that happen. So we are working towards that. I think that gives us some context, right? So in this case, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take the schema one and say that I'm going to accept schema when I pull the data from FTP. And whenever I get data from schema one, what is the corresponding transform file I need to call? And if you have five different transform files in the project system, and if it doesn't have the source type of schema one, it will still show only the first one, because it maps knowing that which map is applicable for the schemas you have selected. So I'm going to say whenever it is message type is schema one, go ahead and execute map one.trfm. And now we have modeled. So what we have done is, whenever I get a message, I want to validate it, transform it, and then finally route it to the on-premise systems. The other quick thing which you can do is with respect to enrich. I just want to spend a minute to explain what are all the enrich parameters we have. So when you want to extract data based on the incoming message, there are various different sources. It could be based on the protocol. If you're sending data via HTTP, you want to get HTTP address. If you're sending the data via SOAP, you might want to get the SOAP action. If you're sending the data via FTP, you might want to get the FTP file name. Or it could be based on the message itself. You want to do an XPath of and take a link in terms of where the particular entry is there. Or you might want to do a data lookup, saying that I have a message, I want to do a data lookup and see where the, what the corresponding value is. So out of the box, we support data enrichment support across protocols in the message body, as well as external data lookup. So if you want to get a data from a HTTP header, all you have to say is, let's say XMS, just name it as version, and property name is P1, data type is string. So here, what I'm saying is I'm creating a new property, which is going to get the data from HTTP header. It's going to look for the header called version, and then promote it to a property called P1. So there are lots of use cases wherein if you want to do data enrichments, you can now do data enrichments across three layers, protocol, message, and data lookup. So in this case, we're not going to do anything. And the final part about the flow is like we have to specify the FTP source. Let me go ahead and bring FTP. Okay. So the FTP location, let's go ahead and key in the details. Okay, let me write it down. VTS. Folder path, and can give slash demo slash view one, and I can say I'm getting all XML files. Right, so let's also quickly validate whether, try one more time for the FTP location. I have to give the username as well. Should connect now, right? So I'm going to create a new folder for the demo location. Let's say it is demo. Right. And this is where I want to pick the data from. So I'll just go ahead and say ticket demo slash demo. Right, so now we have specified the complete end-to-end flow, where you're getting the data from in terms of FTP, and we support FTP and FTP yes, so I just changed the protocol to false so that we use port 21 instead of something else. We have a bridge, which is going to take the data, normalize it, and send it to SQL. And finally, when we send it to SQL, we need to specify the filter condition. Do you always want to send it to the endpoint, or do you want to do it on a conditional basis? And typically, you might have this for content-based routing, where if the message type is A, send it to one endpoint. If it's something else, send it to a different endpoint. And the final part about it is the route action. And the thing to note here is we are exposing a SQL endpoint. We expose a SQL target relay, perform the insert operation. But when you're sending the data to the SQL endpoint, you have to specify what operation you want to invoke. For example, we have exposed both insert and update operations. So when you're sending the data, which operation do you want to invoke? And the way you usually specify that is via SOAP action. So if you go back to the Server Explorer, look at the input we have, insert operation we just did, we know that this is a corresponding SOAP action for the insert operation. So I'll go take that value, go to route action, and think about route action in this way. So it is a new Windows Azure BizTalk service specific implementation, which says that whenever you're sending data out to a destination, do you want to do any specific property over the wire? Do you want to stamp a header? Do you want to make use of an existing property? So that's where when you're sending the data to a route endpoint, what action do you want to invoke? So in this case, I'm going to say I want to set the SOAP action, specify the protocol, because I know I'm sending data via SOAP. And that value is going to be the insert op value. So click OK. Now we have created the build it end to end. Let's go ahead and build this project. And if there are no errors, so it looks like okay. So finally, when you expose this SQL endpoint, if you go, there's a corresponding .config file which gets created. And here you have to specify how you are authenticating to service bus. So you have to specify the ACS credential. So in this case, it is going to be issuer name and secret. So I'm just going to change it to owner and the corresponding file. So replace it. Now you know how to connect to SQL. And if you actually come down, you will see that this endpoint talks to the same target relay which we just created earlier using the Struck adapter service. So with this set, we are done end to end. Let's try to rebuild it now. And yeah, the rebuild succeeded. And now you have to go ahead and deploy. So you click on deploy. And as part of the deployment, there are a couple of things which is interesting to note. We saw it as part of the introduction to Windows Azure BizTalk service. How do you go ahead and provision a new BizTalk service deployment? When you create the deployment, it has its own ACS namespace, and you have to specify the ACS namespace which is tied to your deployment as part of the model pop-up. So here I'm going to say I'm going to use a ACS namespace which I use for this particular deployment. And I'll take its password, just 1 second. Go ahead and do it. Now, we have specified the endpoint in which you're going to deploy. And before I do that, I also need to change. On the bridge configuration surface, you will see the BizTalk service deployment URL. Whenever you create a new BizTalk service, you'll have a corresponding deployment URL, which you can see in the Windows Azure BizTalk portal, Windows Azure portal. So in this case, my deployment endpoint is, I have an internal deployment. I want to specify the deployment endpoint. And now we are good to go. Rebuild it. Click on deploy. So once the deploy gets started, while it goes on, if you see the output window, you'll see that it first deploys the schema artifacts, then the maps, then the target endpoints. And all of this, like you can see the REST endpoints, the HTTP endpoints. We also provide REST API support, and our documentation covers it, wherein if you want to go ahead and query the artifacts, et cetera, you can either do via programmatic access, or you can go to the BizTalk portal and see all the schemas, maps, et cetera, which you have deployed. So in this case, we have already went ahead and deployed the solution. So I'm going to create a new instance for schema1.xsd, generate instance. And the file is here. So I'm just going to take this file, go here, just go here, schema instance1.xml. Go back to the FTP location, drop the file. And the unique part about FTP and SFTP sources is that it is a pull mechanism instead of a push. When you have an HTTP endpoint, you have a client which pushes the data to the HTTP endpoint. Whereas in the case of FTP, what you do is you drop the file and you expect it to be picked up. So we have a separate pull mechanism for it. So in this case, we have a default I believe it's a 30-second window in which it goes ahead and pulls the schema instance. So, so let me go ahead and if you go ahead and see the schema instance file, we provide the message instance creation using the. You can go to Visual Studio while you do that. You can generate an instance, validate an existing instance, or validate the schema as well, if the schema is properly valid or not. And this is the same if you're used to BizTalk server. These are the same set of functionalities, which is there in the services as well. So hopefully, let's see if it got picked up or it ran into some issues. It could be, okay, let's try. Let's try one last thing. Let's also try to post the message. In this case, let's say this is the internal ENV2 address. That's okay. As part of the samples, we have a rich set of tools using which you can send data to the bridge, receive data from a service bus queue, or check the runtime logs, etc. It's part of SDK samples, go ahead and try it. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to use the existing project, and let's see if I can just change this to internal, change the endpoint. To this and change the give the input instance file name. So in this case, I'm going to say this is the XML file I want to send. Let's say, and finally, you're going to specify what kind of data file it is. We support flat file and XML, so I'm going to put. By the way, just so you know, this is a message sender tool which we give, which allows you to send message to bridges. It takes in a bunch of parameters like which deployment you want to send the data to, what kind of file you want to send it, etc. So I'm just providing its parameters. So with this said, let's go ahead and see if it actually works. And this was, it may be most likely like if you see the error, it shows that the username password is incorrect, which means that when I'm sending data to the relay endpoint, let's go back. To the toolbox. The relay which I just created, maybe I just need to update its credential. So just give right. Oh, okay. So I'm doing this from a machine which doesn't have access. So let's go ahead and try it one more time. And give the username, password, and my domain credential. East. All right. So with this done, it should be good. Let's go ahead and disable, enable it. Let's try the message sender one more time, I think. Yeah, so now if you see, like, because the relay endpoint was not up, it threw an error saying the username password was incorrect the last time I keyed in. Now we are able to see the message, and then if I open SQL Management Studio, I'll show in a bit where the corresponding data would also be inserted. How does DB tables? I had two records as part of S3's session, so you probably have the third one now. So with this, we hopefully saw a quick end-to-end demo of how you can expose your LOB endpoint securely in the cloud using BizTalk Adapter Service and use a new Windows Azure BizTalk Service SDK to create an end-to-end flow. Now, once you create that endpoint in BizTalk service, that is already as a cloud endpoint, and you're talking to your on-premise LOB relay. Now, you can create all sorts of rich experiences for different form factors from the client side, wherein you can connect to it from your cloud service, you can connect to it from your Windows Phone mobile app, you can connect to it from your iOS app, you can connect from your tablets, etc. Because it's there in the cloud, all you have to do is authenticate to it. The message center where it showed is actually sends the data to the endpoint using REST. So across the devices, you should be able to go ahead and send devices as well. So with this, let me quickly switch over to the demo and wrap up this session. So what we saw today, hopefully, is a summary of whether how you can enable data flow from cloud to on-premise or from on-premise to the cloud. And the key thing to note here is different customers have different choices, wherein they might be running on-premise, or they can connect to new cloud services and embrace the, some of the new cloud services. Irrespective of whatever the situation is, integration is always has a role to play in it. So using the BizTalk family of products, like BizTalk Server and Windows Azure BizTalk Services, it is very, very easy to enable the cloud connectivity, and hopefully these demos showed a glimpse of it. So with this, thank you very much for attending this talk. And we have one more talk around today evening around extensibility. Chair is going to present. That's at 5 o'clock in the evening. The key focus on that particular session is, okay, you enable validate, you enable the transform, et cetera, but how do I write custom code, or what are the extensibility points in the platform on which I can leverage and make use of? And we have a rich set of extensibility points, and we are going to have a deep dive session on it. And also tomorrow, there's going to be a BizTalk server session, which just talks about the new functionalities in BizTalk Server 2013. And we'll go deep dive in terms of seeing tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock. For BizTalk Server, yes. Server, yeah. So as part of the templates, we provide 3 templates. It contains the latest and greatest of the BizTalk Server. But the BizTalk Services is a different SDK.
Okay.
All right. So that's the services part, which is a platform as a service. And then for the server part, you will get it as part of IS. And so this gives a link of all the, let me go back, our forums, our blog posts, and everything else. So if we, I encourage you to download the SDK, try it out, and also go to the forums to go ahead and try it out. And thank you very much for attending this session, and hopefully we go ahead and...